Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to today's episode of the Dr. J Show, which is a very special episode. Those of you who follow the Ruth Institute will know of Dr. Quentin Van Meter because he's been a speaker at our recent summits for survivors of the sexual revolution, and he's been a guest on this program before. I'm bringing him back today to talk about some very important testimony that he gave to some medical boards in Florida, which had the impact of changing the state's policy towards what is sometimes called trans medicine, or the medical procedures and interventions for children who think they are born in the wrong body. Dr. Van Meter's testimony is very important. And if you have anyone in your family or community that is concerned with these issues and having factual information about it, as opposed to propaganda, you're going to be very interested in this show.
So the Florida Medical Board and the Florida Osteopathic Board were meeting to essentially respond to a bit of turmoil that had arisen regarding the state's position on affirmation interventions, I'll call them. I hate to call them treatments, because treatment would sort of assume it was some kind of beneficial thing, and it is clearly, turns out, not to be. For transgender children, kids who were having issues with feeling like they were born in the wrong body. And this was from young children all the way up through adolescence. The Florida Medical Board is tasked with advising the legislature. It's one of their constitutional things that they're supposed to do about certain areas that become controversial, so that they can do case reviews every year and just establish whether or not physicians are practicing within what should be a standard of care for the state of Florida. So you can see what has happened in terms of every university center must have a transgender clinic, or they're not going to get some funding. They're going to be looked at as second class because they might be discriminating against transgender patients. So they've in a frenzy of wokeness, that each academic institution has a transgender clinic. People who are pretending that there is a standard of care widely adopted, a wide consensus. There is no consensus at all about this. The majority of endocrinologists do not believe that the endocrine guidelines are appropriate, and that the majority of members of the American Academy of Pediatrics, which is 67,000 members, do not believe that affirmation is the way to go, and that any kind of counseling is unethical, which is what the American Academy of Pediatrics policy statement states. Trans advocates, the ideologues, say about 3% of people have ambiguity of their sex, what they call intersex. Intersex is a junk term. It doesn't describe much of anything. It's not a third sex. There's male and there's female. It's clearly binary, biologically established. So let's talk about what gender identity is, because that's actually the initial term. That was coined by Dr. John Money, my buddy from Johns Hopkins all those years ago. And I say that facetiously. He coined that term as the internal, the sense of internal sexual identity of the patient. And most of the time was identical to the biologic sex, but sometimes not. He called that concept transsexuality. And this was back in the 1980s. So that was the first term. And that was actually what was used internationally. And then Dr. Zucker said, hey, wait a minute, a better term for this, in terms of focusing on what it is. It's a disorder. Now, a disorder means it's not normal, and that it was an incongruence of gender identity and biologic sex. And he called it gender identity disorder. And it was in the statistical manual of mental health disorders, the DSM, in volume number 3 and number 4, as describing it. This is what it was. They talked about the fluidity of this disorder, the lack of biologic basis of this disorder, that it was essentially a social, psychological issue. These were all trans advocates. These were all ideologues on this group. And they said, we don't think it's a disorder. We're going to remove it. We removed same-sex attraction as a disorder back in the 70s. We want the same thing to be done to gender. You know, this is a, you know, an authentic self. This is not a disorder. This is, everything is normal in these people. It should not be considered abnormal in any way. And he argued against that and said that, look, that's not going to help these patients at all. They have a lot of mental health issues that need to be addressed. And if you remove the disorder, who's going to pay for something when it's not a disorder anymore? Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, that was the bottom line. He said, hey, you want to get rid of disorder, you're going to have all these people who want medical and surgical interventions, and no one is going to pay. It's going to be a cosmetic thing, purely cosmetic. Right. So out of pocket completely.
Be like getting a nose job.
Yeah. And is that what you want to do to all of our patients? And they said, well, no, we don't want to do that to our patients. And so he said, okay, how about this idea? We'll call it gender dysphoria. Dysphoria is essentially a term that says unhappiness, you know, right. You know, mental anguish, if you will. And so he said, we'll call it gender dysphoria. And it's a term, you know, then if we do that, that is a medical condition. And because of gender dysphoria, all of the interventions then could be possibly covered by third-party payers. It is a mental health issue. They're suffering from the woes of being incongruent, you know, the side effects of it, because, and they blame that on society entirely. This is the minority stress theory. They wouldn't be unhappy if they were just accepted. Well, the reality is they can't accept themselves internally. That is the problem. So, you know, it's not the world against them. It's themselves against themselves. And that's where their angst and depression and just it multiplies. It was there to begin with.
Right.
It caused them to seek a relief. They were made to believe the relief was getting into the other person's body and becoming the other person. And when they got there, they thought, wow, I feel really much better now for a little while. But like the lifetime experience of these individuals, 10 years out, it hits them that they actually are no better off and they're actually worse off.
Right. Let's now talk about John Money and how he fits into this whole story. He also is a psychologist, not an MD. Right. But he had a psychological theory, and he fit him into this whole drama historically, you know, chronologically, where does he fit?
Well, he was a psychologist that trained at Harvard and came to Johns Hopkins in the early 50s. And he came there specifically because Johns Hopkins was sort of the epicenter in North American continent of clinical research and evaluation of fetal development. They were the ones that actually, you know, cataloged and looked at fetal changes in rats and mice, and then subsequently in primates. And then they had opportunities with autopsies and whatnot to look at development of the human fetus. And they said, wow, this is what's happening. I mean, testosterone was known as a hormone. It had been identified, but they knew the pituitary was responsible for sending messages, but they had no idea what the hormones from the pituitary were. They just knew that pituitary was sort of the endocrine center of the universe, and it did a bunch of things. And so they figured out the timing. They figured out that when in the first trimester of the pregnancy, it's mom's gonadotropins from her placenta that are making the changes. And in the last trimester of the pregnancy, it's the baby's pituitary that sort of rekindles and gets things finished. And so they had all this stuff. So then they had all the mishaps, all of the kids who with ambiguous genitalia referred to them because they were kind of the experts. And so John Money said, I'm really interested in human sexuality and messes up in nature. And I want to be at Hopkins because, you know, they got a whole stable of patients, they're babies. And wouldn't it be really cool to see what we could do to babies and see the outcomes were? Okay. So he goes to Hopkins and he kind of sidles up alongside Lawson Wilkins, who was the endocrinology chief at the time. And he actually was the first pediatric endocrinologist in the United States. He was a pioneer in that field. And he said to Lawson Wilkins, "Hey, can I hang around with you?" And so Lawson Wilkins said, "Sure." I mean, here he was an eager clinician, a psychologist, ostensibly, on doing things that were moral and safe, but there were no guidelines for clinical studies on children. They had not even been put together in any shape or form. So Money said, "Well, what if I have an idea? Let's see if what we do to these children, we'll see what the outcome is." And so case by case, families would come in with their kids and he'd be involved. He would interview the family. He would kind of get, what do you think of your baby with this screwed up genitalia? How are you going to relate to that child? And he would sort of interview them. And these interviews were in the patient's record. So you could literally read word for word because they were recorded and then transcribed. And he would sort of suggest things to the parents, and the parents would sort of remain quiet. He'd suggest things to the kids who were older that he dealt with. There was a little boy with a tumor on his in the liver that was producing large quantities of testosterone, and he came in looking like an adult male at age six. Adult male penis and pubic hair. And the family wasn't concerned. He came in for a well visit through the walk-in clinic, and they were kind of dismayed at what they saw. They referred him upstairs, and John Money got a hold of him and was asking this six-year-old boy how often he masturbated. And the kid looked side, and this is all really written in the transcriptions. He looked.
And this is what year? Is this the 50s now?
This is the 70s. Okay.
Oh, by now this is the
70s. By that time. Because he had established this, what it was called, the psychohormonal group. And okay. They were all trained to interview the kids. And so Money said, "Well, how often are you masturbating?" And the kid looked confused. He didn't know what masturbation was. So John Money took a pencil and rubbed up and down it and said, "This is what masturbation is. And your penis gets hard." And so, okay, the boy said, "Well, whatever. Six-year-olds just are not in the frame of mind really to know what that's all about." The next visit, they interviewed him again, said, "How often are you masturbating?" He was masturbating six times a day.
Mm-hmm.
So they taught him to masturbate.
Were his parents in the room while these questions are being
asked? We don't know. That is not documented. Okay.
I see. Interesting.
And so, and I suspect they weren't. And so, this is the kind of thing that Money did to children. And then he would say, "Oh, your baby's genitalia are too female. We're going to suggest that you raise your child as a female." And the parents dutifully did that. That's what we were told. This child is biologically a male, but, has inability to. We would determine it with the possibility of fertility or not. And if there was no fertility in the biologic male to be able to procreate, we would say, "Okay, sure, go ahead, remove the testicles." And so these things were done with the advice of John Money. And it turned out that as these kids grew up, of those kids, three quarters of them went back to their biologic sex when they were free and clear of the Hopkins clinic. The saddest case was the case of a boy who made national news,
a
boy whose penis was burnt off at a botched circumcision. And he was raised by John Money, told me raised as a girl. He had a twin brother. John Money actually invited these kids to play with themselves, their genitalia in the bathtub, and to explore each other's genitalia when they were prepubertal. And this boy ended up at age 13 or 14 finding out, because he demanded to know, why he was so unhappy and depressed. And his clinical therapist said, "I think we need to let him know that, he is not a girl, but he's a biologic male." Right. And right. He did. And the boy said, I just knew all along there was something wrong. And that boy ended up having reconstructive surgery on what was left of his penis, and married and had two children adopted, but he committed suicide as a young adult. And his twin brother became drug addicted and died of a heroin overdose. Mm-hmm. So and Money pretended as if this were in his writings. He wrote what a success this was, that he had, done this wonderful thing, and this family and this child were, but no one knew of the perversion of what he was like. The kids were masturbating each other in the bathtub. None of that was known. It came out later, you know, when and in the story. And by that time, Money was already deposed from his throne at Johns Hopkins. His clinic had been shut down by the director of the psychiatry department, Dr. Paul McHugh, who arrived in about late 70s, early 80s. So that was the tragic case.
And that part, let's pause there for a moment, because there are probably some of our followers who are aware of the fact that Dr. Paul McHugh shut down that clinic because it wasn't helping anybody. He looked at the outcomes, and it wasn't just these little kids. I mean, it was
primarily the adults, because John Money also had a stable of patients, I think 16 adult patients. And he developed, again, a protocol of, I have an idea, let's try this out and see what happens. There were adult males that came to him, but predominantly males. I think there were maybe two of the 16 or 17 were females who wanted to be female. And so he said, okay, this is my protocol. You cross-dress and identify for 2 years as the opposite sex. You stay out of jail. You have to deposit $2,000 into a savings account. And that is our sort of earnest money, if you will. And if you behave, and you then we'll put you on hormones after 2 years, and the opposite sex hormones. And then if all goes well, we'll go ahead and send you to our surgeons, who will, you know, basically take off your testicles and penis and invert the skin and create a pseudo vagina. And voila, you will be a female. And those were called transsexuals. This was the term transsexual that was there at the time. So of those 16 patients, they were followed very closely for their psychological woes. Most of them had anxiety and depression to begin with. And at the end of their 2 years in their new personas, none of them were emotionally any better. And that they did, Paul McHugh said, if we're going to do this, we're going to review the outcomes of what we've done, what you've done, John Money, and we're going to see whether or not there is benefit to these patients. And if there isn't, this program is toast. And that's exactly what happened. They published the article that showed that there was absolutely no improvement in mental health, none whatsoever. So McHugh said, done and done. And he basically told John Money he could no longer publish under the Hopkins, imprimatur, and he could not do any clinical research anymore.
Wow.
And that was the end of Money's career. My personal experience with Money in one particular case was just at the end of my fellowship. There was a family that came down from Buffalo with their little boy who was 6 months of age. And the boy had what was called a micropenis, and they had checked the chromosomes, and this was an XY male. There was a scrotum. There was nothing ambiguous. It's just that the penis was extremely small, less than 3/8 of an inch long, and the testes could not be palpated in the scrotum. But we knew by the chromosome analysis that this was a boy. And so they said, they sent them from Buffalo by bus. Mom and the little baby boy came down, and this was one of my patients that I got to do as an initial workup as a senior fellow. And my faculty mentor and I put together an evaluations and protocol. We did some baseline blood work, and we said, we are going to go ahead and stimulate this baby's testicles with human chorionic gonadotropin. It's the hormone that is produced in the urine of pregnant women. That's what gives you a positive pregnancy test. That hormone is purified and can be given therapeutically, or was given therapeutically, to stimulate the ovaries and testicles of human beings that were possibly infertile. And it was specifically looked at in treatment of infants who had small genitalia, boys with micropenis. What you wanted to find out was, A, you know, if we stimulated the testicles, A, were they there? We couldn't find them. But if they're there, they're going to produce testosterone. If they produce testosterone, does the tissue respond? Mm-hmm. So you got some really good clinical answers out of this protocol that we were working on. And so we gave this child the initial course in the hospital, and John Money happened to be out of the country at the time, and we didn't invite the psychohormonal group to come in and do an evaluation of this child. We knew what we were going to do, and we told the parents, look, this is what we're looking for. We're going to see you back in at the end of 12 weeks, which is the end of the protocol. And we're going to see what kind of tissue response there was. And we're going to measure testosterone levels and look at the genitalia and see if everything went the direction that says, hey, this is going to be a potentially fertile boy. Mm-hmm. So we sent the patient off on the bus, and lo and behold, money had come back unbeknownst to us from his trip and got wind of this patient and grabbed the mom before they left the floor of the hospital and invited them down to talk to them, and basically said, oh, those endocrinologists, they don't know what they're talking about. There's no possibility that your child is ever going to function as a male ever. Penis that can't be made into anything. I'm going to recommend that you essentially take your baby home. Yeah, let them do the treatment protocol. It's not going to work. I want you to choose a female name, and I want you to let everybody in the family know that there was a mistake in the identification of the baby, and that you actually have a baby girl, and I want you to dress the baby as a girl and treat the baby as a girl. So we didn't know that was John Money had done that. We didn't find that out until the patient came back at the end of the treatment protocol, and we undiapered this little boy who had a totally normal penis and the testes of, you know, normal infant size, testosterone levels that were measurable. If we had not known that, if John Money had been in charge of this kid, this totally healthy baby boy would have been an infertile, surgically damaged female. And actually not a female, but a surgically damaged male. So that was John Money. I mean, he damaged kids. He was responsible.
Had they been treating the child as a girl during that 12
came back period? The baby came back in an eyelet bonnet and a pink dress, but grandma, she, bless her heart, she said, I wondered why we had to call it the baby by a female name, because I was just watching, I was changing the diapers, and I saw some real significant changes, and I thought, That's no girl. That's no girl. But she was so happy, and mom was quite relieved. But the mother was distraught because
you're there with your baby, and you're trusting the doctors, and you're getting contradictory information like that, and money did this behind your back.
Yes,
that's completely. That's wow. Oh,
I never. I did not see him physically again, or I would have had, I'm not sure what I would have said to him in that regard, because it was the end of my fellowship. It was right at the end. The head of the pediatric endocrine division told him he could not intervene with any of our patients without specifically going through the department head anymore.
And what year was this?
1979. The spring of 1980, actually.
Okay. And what year did Dr. McHugh shut down the whole program?
Within a year of that.
So roughly 1980.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was based on how many years of experience and follow-up?
That was probably 10 years of experience in adults.
Okay. Yeah. In adults, yeah. Right. In adults. Okay. And so Dr. McHugh just put the kibosh on it at that point. Okay. Yeah. Now, what's happened at Hopkins since? Has that program, some version of that program, resurrected? I mean, do they do trans medicine now at Hopkins?
Oh my gosh, about 4 years ago, the Children's Hospital monthly or annual magazine that comes out describing new things that are happening at the Johns Hopkins Children's Center published a whole article on their transgender clinic, their brand spanking new clinic. And that they were so glad because John Money had pioneered all this stuff, and they were, and I read that in the magazine, and I actually wrote a letter to the editor of that magazine saying, "Are you out of your mind? You're resurrecting,
they're rehabilitating Money, they're
John Money. I mean, it was shame and whoa, and you're trying to make him a saint, and shame on you. I mean, and having a transgender clinic and being proud of it is the wrong answer. They never published the letter, or I never heard a peep back from the editor.
Right. So what I want to do now is shift gears and talk specifically about the children, about trans medicine in children, because there are some new issues, right? Because it's being done so commonly now in a way that John Money couldn't do or get away with, or however you want to put that, there are now, the new issues are coming to the fore. So, and in your testimony here, you bring up several, you refute several, I don't know what you'd call them, talking points. You know, you go through kind of point by point and uncover what is commonly said and what you believe is more a more accurate situation. Right. Okay. And so the first one that I came across is you've got a section called the etiology of gender disorders. And you talk about the claims that some males have, quote, feminized brains. So talk to us about that claim. What does that claim mean? And what is the evidence for and against that claim?
Well, what they did is they looked at the MRI scans, and this is not the most high quality study, just a simply static view of the brain at one sitting, not looking at function or vascularity or receptor changes. They just took a picture, an MRI picture of the brain of I think six adult transgender trans females. And what they mean by that is a biologic male who has assumed the role and the persona of a female. And they looked at the brain studies and then said, oh my goodness, there's an area here in these six studies we are looking at that normally is more prominent in the female brain of the normal, you know, adult female. And so they said, this indicates that there's a biologic basis for the wrong brain in the wrong brain in the body, that theory. Well, the problem with that is that there is no reliable difference in brain morphology that is across the board that says this is definitely a male or definitely a female. There is crossover to such a high degree that you cannot, a radiologist cannot look at an MRI of the brain and say, this is the MRI of a female, blinded. This is an MRI of a female. And this one over here is an MRI of a male. There's no possible way to make that diagnosis. So it has very little to do with, you know, biology and you know, biologic basis of gender identity being in the an issue. It speaks more to the functionality of the environment. Okay. So an example being that taxi drivers in London, before GPS was available, the taxi drivers were people who memorized the entire street grid of London. And they programmed that. They trained and trained and trained and trained. And they were, that's how they could be licensed cabbies, is if they knew every nook and cranny and street and corner and alley by name and its location. The MRI scans of those cab drivers were different than the standard population that was just randomly chosen. And that's because the environment that had worked on them, they didn't become cab drivers because their brains were that way. Their brains changed because of the environment, what's called neuroplasticity.
Right.
And neuroplasticity is responsible for people post-stroke being able to regain language function and motor skills, because the brain is plastic and it works and rewires and it changes its morphology based on the environment and the experiences of that person. So neuroplasticity explains that, biology does not.
And so you've got in the first place a study with six subjects,
yeah, six
data points,
yeah,
and an alternative explanation,
right.
a very plausible alternative explanation. So this is a non-starter. This idea.
It is, and then the other, if you really wanted to find that out, you would have serial MRI studies from infancy through young childhood,
correct,
through adolescence, through young adulthood, through mid adulthood, that would always show these persistences of differences in development that had to do with biology. And of course, there are no studies to show that. And there, you know, nothing suggests that it should be that way.
Right, right. So let's move on and talk about puberty blockers, because you've got an extensive discussion of puberty blockers in here. And this is something that people don't really understand, I think. What was the purpose for which puberty blockers were originally developed? And what purpose are they being used for today?
They originally were developed to shut down the testicular production of testosterone in adult males with prostate cancer. Because they needed to get rid of the prostate without getting rid of the testicles. Okay, that they were trying to spare the testicles instead of sterilizing the male. It was a temporary shutdown to make sure that testosterone disappeared from the environment. So that's where it was first used in adults, and then the idea came along, and it made perfectly good sense. We were dealing with children who were three, four, five, 6 years old who had started to actually go into true puberty. And the problem with that is they end up profoundly short. And there are a lot of social issues that happen because, you know, a six-year-old with adult levels of testosterone is sometimes not going to be socially appropriate with their sexual libido-driven behaviors. And a female who is menstruating in the first grade has a lot of social problems with that. I mean, it's very hard for that child not to feel completely different and very much emotionally upset. So the puberty blockers were then, these drugs were then used to block precocious puberty. Puberty in a girl that was full-fledged started before their eighth birthday, puberty that was full-fledged started in a boy before their ninth birthday. Now, there are questions about fertility, you know, is that preserved? Some very limited studies, but there's no other alternative. And so you know, this is what we have. It has some side effects with some emotional up and down upsets in a couple of the kids, more often in adults. But you know, it's a limited population. The puberty blockers are, I would say, in a given year, I might see six or seven new patients with precocious puberty.
So it's not intended. It's intended to delay puberty,
right.
not end it.
Correct.
Right. Okay. Right. Yeah. And so that's the rub. That's the difference between what's being done for precocious puberty versus what's being done for some kind of gender dysmorphia, whether you want to call it.
Incongruence.
That's probably the best word. Okay. So the using it for gender incongruence, the intention is that there's never going to be puberty. It's for kids.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
So what are the problems with taking that protocol that works fine for a 6 to 12 year old and then extending it through further? What are the problems associated with that?
Well, puberty has a purpose. I mean, it has a very distinct purpose. It takes a non-fertile prepubescent child, a male or female, and turns them into a reproductive adult. Okay. It is multifactorial. It affects the skeleton. It affects the brain. It clearly affects the gonads. It makes them develop and become sperm producing or egg producing. It allows the opportunity for conception. And so it is a very important part of maturation that if you take that away, the big thing is bone calcification in the female patients in particular. Estrogen is so essential for an adolescent female to maintain calcium stores in the skeleton that past the 25th birthday, no matter how much calcium you give, if you haven't had calcium all the way through your adolescent years up to age 25, you're going to have severe osteoporosis as an adult, fractures and things like that. And so it is really important to allow a female to go through puberty. That's why we get so upset with some of the super, super athletes and female gymnasts who spontaneously just delay puberty. Their pituitary shuts down because their body fat content is so low. The brain takes on the idea that this is not going to be a potential nursing mother who can, you know, take care of their child. So we're going to keep that in wraps until this nonsense goes away and the body fat comes back up. And when that happens, we're going to allow this female to begin to mature and cycle. So those girls who have severe delays in puberty, they're on estrogen supplements because they are birth control pills to get them going because their skeleton needs to have them be producing estrogen along. And that cannot be regained. When you shut that down, you never can regain that.
It's like a window. It's like there's a developmental window. And once you're past it, you're past it.
Right. What happens here in the United States is at the first sign of any pubertal change, it is blocked right then and there. So the testicles in the female and the ovaries in the male and the ovaries in the female never get a chance to be on the maturational pathway. So you're inviting infertility that maybe might be reversible when someday you quit that and didn't do anything else.
Right.
But you're basically starting to sterilize the patient.
Right.
Okay. Right then and there with puberty blockers. And so in the United States, the guidelines said, you know, we're supposed to wait until they're 16 before we give them cross-sex hormones. So that would be onset of puberty, which for girls is 10 and a half on an average. And you wait until they're 16. Okay, that's 5.5 years of blocked puberty, 5.5 years of no estrogen in, you know, bringing calcium into the skeleton. And then at age 16, you start treating these girls with testosterone to masculinize them. Okay, well, that doesn't happen. What's happening, this is not per protocol, but this is what the patients come and tell us is happening, is that they get a puberty blocker after the very first visit, and that within a year, they start them on cross-sex hormones. Because guess what? Their peers are going into puberty, and these kids want to appear to be going into puberty of the sex they want to become.
Gotcha.
So they basically say, you know, it's basically a conveyor belt. They walk in the door. They're given the psychological evaluation is, are you crazy or not? That's the difference. You know, are you in, you know, can you tell real from unreal? Meaning schizophrenia and other severe mental disorders. They don't care about depression and anxiety. They'll deal with that later. And they say that's all due to lack of acceptance, not due to an undercurrent mental health issue, which is really what's going on. And so they say, we'll block puberty right away. And as soon as you want to go into puberty because your peers are going to puberty, we'll get you on those cross-sex hormones. They have completely, by the end of the blocking and the cross-sex hormones, essentially sterilized the child. This is sterilization. We don't want to call it affirmation. We are calling it what it is, sterilization of children. Okay. Can they sign consent for that? No, because they're not of the age of being able to sign consent. Can their parents consent to have their children sterilized? What country is this? What decade is this? This is not the 1920s where, you know, mentally retarded kids were thrown into institutions and sterilized so that they just, you know, they would be not get pregnant and they would be out of harm's way. Or would not procreate if you're feeble-minded people, like, you know, the whole beginning of Planned Parenthood, Margaret Sanger, feeble-minded people, blacks and others that they wanted to eliminate from society, they wanted to sterilize them.
Well, and Oliver Wendell Holmes's famous thing in Buck versus Bell, where he says three generations of imbeciles are enough.
Yeah. Yeah.
Buck versus Bell has never been overturned as far as I know. But but anyway, what you're saying here is that even the Dutch protocol, which was had some questionable elements to it, they're not even doing that. It's completely, in a sense, consumer driven. You could say if the girl comes in and wants it, she gets it. Pretty much.
Okay. Yeah.
And you make this statement, and this is in your written testimony.
Yeah.
It's sort of what you just said, and I'm quoting: without any verifiable safety data, using the puberty blockers for interrupting normal puberty is not a sanctionable off-label use of these drugs and is therefore to be considered an uncontrolled, non-consentable experimentation on children.
Yes, that puts it that those words are that statement is absolutely true.
Yeah, and that's what you said in your was this, by the way, this testimony that you gave, was this sworn testimony or?
It had to be notarized. So it wasn't in a court of law. So they could just take a notarized statement.
Okay. And then later on in this paper, you make this other statement. It's difficult to imagine ethical controlled clinical trials that could elucidate the effects of delaying puberty until the age of consent.
Right.
Right. In other words, what controlled clinical trials would it take for you to say this is safe enough to do? You can't even imagine it because all the subjects are below the age of consent by definition.
Right. And no institutional review board would approve of a protocol or a consent form that says, we're going to do this when we know that these are the possible things that can happen: sterilization, loss of bone mineralization, mental health disorders, those being the big three. And we're going to compare you to a group, age matched, socioeconomically matched, in a controlled trial. And this will go on for 20 years. Mm-hmm. And we're going to look at all body functions. We're going to look at brain issues. We're going to do this and show that this is safe or not safe. No IRB would ever approve that. Okay. So it's not done. And because it's not done, these clinics are basically flying low outside of regulation.
So what you're saying is if you ask the question, is this consentable? As soon as you ask the question, the question answers itself.
Yes.
Absolutely not. Right. Yeah. And so what they're doing is not asking. They're just pretending it's not an issue.
Right.
And they said,
we'll see what happens at the end of the road. It's the old John Money thing. I have an idea. Let's see what happens.
Right. Right.
We can't go back to the dark ages of unconsented scientific experimentation on children or adults, for that matter.
No, exactly. Exactly. And that's where some of our friends on the legal side come into the question.
Yes.
Because they are now gathering the data. They're keeping an eye on this, believe me, that there are potential lawsuits down the road here. You talk about what we know and what we don't know, and you talk about embarrassingly unscientific convenience samples, short-term convenience samples. Talk a little bit about some of the studies that you think are embarrassing.
So when you do a study, you're going to want to essentially have a hypothesis, and you're going to want to show that whatever intervention you did to the entire population, which you keep track of every single person in the study, and you say what happened when we did this, was there an outcome and was it measurable and was it desirable or undesirable? Were there more undesirable things than desirable things? That's the scientific method. So there aren't any studies anywhere close to that, except in sort of a retrospective view. What I was talking about is prospective studies where you actually have control. And if somebody drops out, you find out why, but you keep following that person. Even if they drop out of the study, you look at what's going on with that patient's health and life, even if the intervention was not continued. You do not allow attrition. I mean, the death of a patient, if it happens, should be a signal that stops the study right there.
Right. That's right. That's right.
until you show that it was, and those are reviewed, that's 24 hours within 24 hours of a patient's hospitalization or death, the institutional review board must know about that. And all the details must be evaluated by the committee, the safety committee, and they find out if there's cause and effect or if, the reason the patient died was because they were run over by a tractor on the
farm. Right.
Unrelated. The study can go on. But if it's even possibly related to the drug, the study is literally at that instant done. That's the ethical way to do it.
Right.
So the only place, no studies have ever been done like that. So the next best thing is to do a retrospective view of an entire population. Well, there are the country of Sweden, like all the Scandinavian countries, people are followed from cradle to grave. Every medical intervention within their healthcare system is recorded, whether they like it or not. They don't have to give permission. It's there. The data is there. So they looked at two segments of the population. They looked at the segment of the population two time periods for 30 years up until 2011. They took every single transgender patient in the registry, which was everybody that had that diagnosis, not those that answered a survey, with an incentive of a credit card, gift card,
Right.
And they were controlled. I mean, the patients couldn't be counted twice, three times, four times. It was the data. And they looked at that study and published in 2011 that compared to the non-transgender population of Sweden, the transgender patients who had surgical and medical intervention killed themselves, not threatened to kill themselves, actually took their lives 20 times more than the general population did.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. That should have just said, hey, what we've been doing clearly is far more harmful than beneficial.
It's not working.
The problem was the ideologues went right after that paper and tore it to shreds, saying, well, there was no control group. They didn't compare it to medical intervention only or counseling only. There was no comparison. Therefore, you can't make conclusions about cause and effect. period. Well, that not quite so. Okay. Not in, in that, because it was every patient, and they had a, you know, here they were at the end, and compared to people who weren't trans, their outcomes were terrible. Okay. Right. Now, the number of people in the trans community who took their lives was a very small fraction of them, but that is unacceptable as an outcome. I mean,
right.
You know, if you have a amusement park ride and it says there's a 1 in 100 chance that you're going to be dead at the end of the ride if you get on here, and about a 10% chance that you're going to be physically maimed and injured, nobody would license that amusement park ride to be opened or used. Okay.
Right.
Here you are talking about a tiny fraction of the trans adult adults having a miserable outcome. They then looked back at other sort of less severe types of men and found out that there was no decrease at all in visits to mental health institutions, and that mental health did not improve at all in this total group, looking throughout and time periods, how many clinic visits, what prescriptions were written for, you know, for antidepressants and whatnot. There was no improvement over the, you know, in the people that were affirmed. None whatsoever. And actually the opposite was true, that there was some downsides to that. Because of that, the lead author of that study was made to stand up and say she really didn't mean what she published. Okay. I mean, that's how the social pressure, that's the vicious, you know, background ideologue social pressure. So glibly now the trans activists say, oh, that was a terrible study. It's old data. I mean, that was long ago. Now, today is today. That was then, and didn't relate, and it wasn't a good study. Okay, they just write it off glibly. What they do quote as studies that they think are scientifically valid are taken from giant databases of surveys done by the Trevor Project, which is clearly an ideology-driven right. group, and the transgender registry in the United States of 25,000 people, okay? And they teased out, they can go in that database. Now, these were not people that were in a study. These are hand-selected data that they want to pull out and try to create a cause and effect, okay? It's called, you know, sampling, and it's not, it's a observational study. It's not a design study where there is a comparison group or even just a protocol that's followed. These were just everybody that answered, and these were people that answered the question, hey, this, we're going to do a survey. You want to answer this? We're going to give a gift card, okay?
Right. And so this, you know, is what, not... people have known going all the way back to Kinsey. One of the criticisms of Kinsey's work, some of it, was volunteer bias.
Yeah.
The person who volunteers to participate in the study is going to be systematically different from everybody else.
Absolutely. And so that's the convenience sampling part. Okay.
Right.
You cannot, and there is just a rule of science that has existed forever, that you cannot show cause and effect with observational studies. You can't. You can show parallel events happening, perhaps,
right,
but you cannot say this causes that, and therefore you should intervene in a certain way because it's based on science. All the data that they quote are all on observational studies. That's been pointed out.
Right.
Even so, the second total population study from Sweden was published in 2020 of the population since 2011 up to 2020 of patients that were followed who had medical and surgical interventions, purporting in the original paper that medical intervention did not improve medical health at 10 years at all. No improvement whatsoever, but that surgical intervention did. So that paper was torn to shreds by people who reviewed it and said, excuse me, the data you're using are absolutely backwards. It turns out that surgery didn't improve anything at all. And instead of retracting that paper, the authors were allowed to answer with a letter to the editor and say, perhaps we were overzealous in our conclusion.
Now, I want to talk about this because we interviewed Andre von Moll on this very paper.
Brandstrom papers.
Brandstrom and Pachinkas.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And here's what Dr. von Moll said. He said, we didn't want them to retract it. We wanted it corrected and left in the record, right?
Yeah.
What they had originally said was incorrect, and
yeah.
and a bunch of people jumped on that, and it was, you know, to me it was like one of the few times that anything like that actually took place in a journal, you know, that they admitted something was wrong and the correction was published and the correction is there. Yeah. So that and people can go watch my conversation with Dr. Von Moll back in the year 2020, you know, when this went down. You know, there are other issues that are similar to this that have a similar structure. Our friend, Dr. Father Paul Sullins, has looked at some of the studies that purport to show that so-called conversion therapy or sexual orientation change efforts, that harms people.
Right.
And one of them is exactly the opposite of what you're saying here in terms of cause and effect, is like the people who have who went to therapy are more likely to kill themselves. But they didn't ask the question, were they more likely to go to therapy because they were already sicker, you know? And so you can time it, right? You can time that, you know, they're in rough shape mentally, they go for therapy, suicide or not suicide, ideation or not, you know, and they could have asked that question and refused to ask it. So they left out the intervening step. And of course, the causality,
it can't
be correct, right? Right. But what they posited can't be correct. So these kind of tricks, you know, I want people to understand that these kind of tricky things that are done with the data, you really need to keep an eye on these people because they're shameless. I would consider this to be shameless.
And the sad thing is that the busy pediatrician or family practice doc, you know, does not, he just reads the abstract and does not go to the tables and does not know how to critically look at the construct of the article to see whether or not what it says, it purports to say in the title is true. They'll just see the title. They'll say, Oh my gosh. Okay. So this study proves this. All right. Yeah. That's another one.
All right.
Another one. All right. Another one. Another one. Fine. All right. I may not feel comfortable with this, but I'll just send them over to the transgender clinic. And that's what we're supposed to do.
Right.
And that's how it happens.
That's how it happens. Yep. Right. And it's just something people need to be gentle. This is how this consensus gets created, right? They censor out the people who don't agree.
Well, there's a hole in the consensus, if you will, from the American Academy of Pediatrics. And one of the pediatricians that also happens to be a member of the Society of Evidence-Based Gender Medicine, which is a phenomenal group of, you know, political left, political right, everybody in between. They don't care about the politics. They care about the science. Yeah. And they have literally torn everything to shreds that gets published on these, you know, articles that claim to purport benefit from interventions to affirm a gender, incongruent gender. And so this one pediatrician put together a resolution for the annual forum of the American Academy of Pediatrics, laying out with beautiful referencing, since there is not a consensus, and since there is no scientific basis which can be proven and shown that this is safe and effective, perhaps the American Academy of Pediatrics should revise its policy statement using a committee of broad opinions and whatnot. So that was brought up as a resolution. It was buried. It was voted on by the members. This was during COVID, so it was done remotely. It had 80% of those who responded. Again, that's a convenient sample. Okay.
Right.
I'm sorry, but it was those people that answered the question about, is this, do you want to pass this resolution? 80% of the people that responded said, yes, we want this resolution to be passed. And we want the administration of the American Academy of Pediatrics to respond to it. It disappeared. As if it never was there. I mean, the administration just buried it. They brought it up again this summer at the leadership forum, and they made a rule change that didn't even allow it to come up for discussion.
Wow.
And so there was dissent. There's clear dissent within the membership of the American Academy. They do not have 67,000 pediatricians behind them.
Right.
You know, that pediatricians don't know what's going on. And so to say that 67,000 pediatricians agree that this is appropriate care is to lie.
Right. Yeah. And this, the fact that these type of resolutions disappear tells you that they know something's wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
They know they cannot defend it scientifically.
Yeah.
And that's what that bottom line. Listen, Ruthies, if you've listened this far, congratulations. we should send you a prize if you listened this far. But Dr. Van Meter, I want you to tell people just briefly, you mentioned this one organization. Mention the organization that you're president of, because people need to know about it. And Ruthie's, you need to tell your pediatrician to join Dr. Van Meter's organization.
Okay.
Tell people a little bit about it.
The American College of Pediatricians is a group of pediatricians who believe that what we do as pediatricians needs to be the best possible medicine available for children based on science, not based on ideology or the whims or wishes of an adult. So everything that we look at, every subject, every statement we do is scientifically reviewed, vetted by an independent committee, voted on by the whole membership as to whether or not they, and again, it's somewhat of a convenient sample because, you know, we have a policy that if 25% of the membership of the college says the article should not be published, it will not be published. It will not become a policy statement. But mm-hmm. we invite our membership openly on every single policy statement that we make to review it, to make comments. We want to be a big tent that accepts the whole wide opinions and accepts criticism and revises our statements appropriately for, you know, if somebody calls to question something and brings up a point that's scientifically valid. We are open-minded and will listen, and we are open for dialogue. And so that is the basis of what medical care should be for children in this country. It should be what is best for children and what does no harm. Okay. It's the old Hippocratic, oath is that we say, above all, do no harm.
Right.
So if we're very critical of things that fall outside those kinds of guidelines, and we want pediatricians in our organization that parents can trust, that are not going to go off on a tangent because something is the newest, wokest thing on the planet, and jump on a bandwagon and then 10 years later regret because of all of the bad things that happen. Okay.
Right.
That's what happens with things like the policy statement from the American Academy of Pediatrics. They've done that with circumcision. Oh my gosh. They have been on the fence, off the fence, over one side of the fence, back again on the issue of male circumcision. They were on the fence and over on the other side for female genital nicking. When that was brought up as part of the Muslim culture, they said that was okay. And then, oops, they got such a backlash. I mean, they put their finger up in the air, say, what's the person, the popular, what did we hear from the news? Oh,
right.
It was an
event. Right.
We'll retract that. Sorry, right. We didn't say that,
Right.
And that's not how you govern and represent pediatricians. That is an organization that is all into the politics, all into what's popular, what the adults want, to the disadvantage of children, and the American College of Pediatricians stands against that kind of philosophy.
Well, Dr. Van Meter, this has been a very enlightening discussion. We'll probably release it in segments, but it's been a very enlightening discussion, and I'm sure that many people are going to be blessed by it. And I hope that Ruth Institute followers will take courage from what Dr. Van Meter has said, that there are people who can support scientifically the things that you intuitively know in your heart to be true. Dr. Van Meter and his colleagues are there to provide the scientific basis for that. And so I would encourage you to look up the American College of Pediatricians. I would encourage you to look up the Society of Evidence-Based Gender Medicine, and we'll have all of those links right there in the show notes. Dr. Van Meter, thank you so much for being my guest today on this very special edition of the Dr. J Show.
Dr. Morris, thanks so much. I always enjoy talking with you and enjoy sharing my thoughts with you.